Let's turn together tonight to Psalm 36. Psalm 36 to the choir master of David, the servant of the Lord. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. There is no fear of God before his eyes. For he flatters himself in his own eyes that his iniquity cannot be found out and hated. The words of his mouth are trouble and deceit. He has ceased to act wisely and do good. He plots trouble while on his bed. He sets himself in a way that is not good. He does not reject evil. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God! The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light. O continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your righteousness to the upright of heart. Let not the foot of arrogance come upon me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evildoers lie fallen. They are thrust down, unable to rise. So far the reading from God's word this evening. May he add its blessing to our hearts. Well, there's a wonderful power in contrast. If we were to convert one of our Christian education, our Sunday school rooms, and make one wall pure white, and have you sit down in front of that wall and just look at that wall, and as part of that painting, put one little dot of black right in the middle of that white wall, all you would do is look at that black dot. And the same would be true if we reversed it. If we painted a wall completely black and we made a little white circle on it, all we would do is look at that white dot, because the contrast is so stark in our own minds. It's actually seen in other ways as well. One of the favorite things that my wife likes to laugh at me for is if I stand next to a tall person. And never is the contrast greater. A tall man next to a short person, you see the qualities so strikingly as the opposites are next to each other. The opposite qualities are accentuated when we're dealing with stark contrast. And that's what David's doing in this psalm. He's dealing with stark contrast. He's dealing with a contrast that should be so striking that it should affect within us something of praise to God, because he is looking at the contrast between God and man. And his approach is not to declare as a mighty king. He's not coming as David, the royal king. You notice that right in the introduction. David comes here, as it says in the superscript, as the servant of the Lord, meaning that David has already understood something of what he's talking about in this psalm. He has already understood that he comes in the presence of God as a man. And he has understood what a man is. David, you understand, by looking at himself, has seen the astounding difference between man's desires and God's desires, between man's nature and God's nature. And in David's own mind, as he writes it down in this psalm, it accentuates for him the dependence that man has on God and his Christ for his deliverance. So we want to look in this psalm first at the heart of man as it's described in verses 1 through 4. Then we want to see by contrast the heart of God in verses 5 through 9. And then we want to look at the work of God in verses 10 through 12. So there is an astounding difference recorded here in this psalm between man's and God's desires, man's and God's natures, which highlights for us our dependence on God and his Christ. And we're going to look at the heart of man, the heart of God, and the work of God. So we're going to begin by looking at the heart of man as it's described for us in the first four verses of this psalm. David begins by discussing man in his natural state. And as he describes man in his natural state, he's making an observation about the native tongue of the natural man. David is speaking of the language that flows from his heart, and he identifies it for us right in the first verse of this psalm, the first word of it. Transgression. Transgression, by its very definition, is going against law, going against rule. And the transgression of this psalm isn't necessarily David speaking of transgressing the law of a king or a kingdom somewhere, although that can be considered transgression. But here David is speaking specifically about transgression against God. And you can see that because in the second part of that first verse, he speaks of the fear of God. He's not speaking of the fear of a ruler, of a civil government. He's speaking of God and man's relationship with God. And in man's relationship with God, his natural language is transgression. That's the natural state of man. Now, if transgression is going against the law, and if in going against the law here in view is the law of God, the practice of man in his natural state, his natural language is sin. That's what 1 John 3 verse 4 talks to us about when it describes what man's relationship to God is. There in 1 John 3 and verse 4, it says that everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness, transgression. Sin is lawlessness. Sin is transgression. So here, man in his natural state is a practicer of lawlessness. He is a practicer of sin. The heart of the wicked is given to sin. It is the very core of their being. Transgression speaks to the wicked, not just on a surface level. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. And so David is making an observation. What is natural man like? He's a sinner. This is man post-fall. After the fall, when man sinned, when Adam ate of the forbidden fruit and God's curse was applied to his nature, to his heart, and to all those who proceed from him by natural generation, his children born in the ordinary way, they are born in sin because of the action of their father, Adam. The heart of sin is in the essence of the natural man. And from this essence of the natural man flows the action of the natural man. His mind is corrupted. Man's mind is corrupted. His desires are corrupted. His motives are corrupted. And that's when you can speak biblically about the idea of the human heart, the motives, the will, the volition, the desires of man, all of them corrupted. And this is the doctrine of original sin, of course. This is what David is describing in the heart of man. He is describing a heart given over to sin. Now, in our confession of faith in the sixth chapter, we have a whole chapter that deals with the sin of man and the punishment of that sin. And in the second paragraph of this confession, they make a very good summary statement about what it means that man is under original sin. So, speaking of the sin of eating of the forbidden fruit, the confession says this. It says, by this sin, they fell from their original righteousness and communion with God, and so became dead in sin and wholly defiled in all the parts and faculties of soul and body. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. David is describing man under the effects of original sin. Original sin describes the condition of every human being's heart outside of Christ. And that's why transgression speaks to him. Because transgression is a reflection of what he wants in his heart. Ever since the fall, man has cried out in rebellion against God, and transgression is rebellion against God. So when natural man hears transgression, he says, yes, that's what I want. I want transgression. I want to break the law of God. It is the language of the shadows, this transgression. It is the language of darkness. It is the language of death. Original sin is the guarantee of condemnation of man apart from Christ. That means that anybody who is born in the world is already under original sin, so that anybody born in the world apart from Christ is already condemned before God. Now, this is very much contrary to what the world would teach us. Ever since the 18th and 19th century, there's been this notion that man's heart is a blank slate, that simply the right influences on the child would lead him to righteousness, would lead him to good living. And the doctrine of original sin says that's not true. That in man's very being, in his core, deep inside his heart, he speaks one language. And that language is transgression. That language is sin. And that language is rebellion. Original sin says that man's heart is defiled in all its parts and his guilt is therefore established. Every human being is this way. Now, if this was not true, wouldn't it be cruel to allow your innocent children to grow into adulthood where they will sin and become condemned? Original sin is at the very essence of man, and it is the very foundation of man's condemnation. And it is in this doctrine of original sin that our need for a Savior is most clearly established. But because of the doctrine of original sin, we have the heart of a man which is corrupt to its core. And out of this corrupted core flow all our actions. Our actual sins, our actual transgressions flow from our original sin. So though we are already condemned before God because of our nature, because our nature is corrupt, we add to this condemnation with our transgressions that we commit day after day. So all the little sins and all the big sins that we commit from day to day, though they flow from our original sin, add to our guilt in the presence of God. And that's what David is talking about when he says that there is no fear of God before the eyes of the transgressors. That this man doesn't fear God in the sense of stand in awe of him. The fear of God is repressed in the natural man. And so the natural man's actions will always reflect his heart. Again, the sixth chapter of our Confession of Faith is very helpful to summarize the result of our original sin, or as the confession calls it, our original corruption. It says in the fourth paragraph of that same sixth chapter, "From this original corruption, whereby we are utterly indisposed, disabled, and made opposite to all good, and wholly inclined to all evil, do proceed all actual transgressions." So man is committed with all his heart in his rebellion to God. And you see the fruit of that commitment of the natural man work itself out in his actions. But natural man, of course, has a solution because he has to deal with something. Our natural inclination as human beings is never to rush headlong towards destruction. You can see that even in something as simple as when you're being asked to prick your finger with a needle to draw some blood. Maybe you're doing a little experiment where you have to put a little bit of your blood on a slide so you can look at it under a microscope. We shy away from that. Or you hear of people who have been in military training and the training that has to happen in order to convince people to run towards the gunfire instead of away from the gunfire. There is a natural desire in man to preserve himself. So for the natural man who is rushing headlong towards his destruction, something has to happen. He has to do something to convince himself that he's actually not in trouble. And that's what David's talking about in verse 2, where he speaks of the flattery that the natural man has in his own eyes, this story that he tells himself that his iniquity can't be found out, that his iniquity won't be hated. In Jeremiah 17 and verse 9, the King James Version, I actually like how the King James Version records this verse, speaking of the human heart and how deceitful it is. It says, "The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked." Well, it's deceitful not only towards others, but it's deceitful towards yourself. You don't even know the depth of your own depravity as a natural man. You trick yourself. You fool yourself. You tell yourself that you're a good person. The natural man tells himself that either his iniquity isn't against anybody who is real, that is the claim of the atheist, God isn't real anyways, what does it matter what we do? Or he convinces himself that his iniquity actually isn't that bad, that his iniquity is outweighed by his good actions. And isn't this the account that the world gives to us when we ask them if they will be in heaven with God? The vast majority of Americans would answer that they would be in heaven, of course, because they've been pretty good people. This is a work of self-deception, a work of self-deception from the eyes of a natural man looking at his own heart. So the natural man, rather than seeking the end of his sin, like a regenerate person does, the natural man is committed in his whole heart to his sin, his transgression. And it will be seen in his word. It will be seen in his deeds. That's what verse 3 is talking about. The words of his mouth and his actions are not good, are not wise. They are trouble and they are deceit. The natural man is corrupt in all his ways. This is one of the most noticeable ways in which he is different from the regenerate. It's different. He's different in his commitment to folly and to evil. That doesn't mean that this psalm is saying that the righteous is perfectly sinless. It doesn't mean that the righteous isn't ever struggling with sin or is always wise. But the wicked sets himself apart in his commitment to folly, his commitment to evil, his commitment to idolatry. He's so committed to it, in fact, that verse 4 describes him as sitting on his bed thinking of trouble for the next day. That which is antithetical to God's law, he's thinking about it even when he has a chance to rest. He is on the broad way that leads to destruction, and he is running headlong down this road. And when he sees evil, and when he encounters sin, he doesn't flee from it, but he embraces it. So what's David done here in the first four verses? He has taken a wall in our Sunday school room, and he's gotten his rollers out, and he's got his paint trays, and he's taken a couple of gallons of the blackest paint you could ever imagine. And he's painted that wall so black that it's unmistakable. This is who natural man is. Natural man is committed in his rebellion. Natural man is unrepentant in his rebellion, and natural man embraces rebellion in his words and in his thoughts. It's a stark picture of the human condition. But then David does something else. In making the black as he does, our eyes would immediately be drawn to that which is opposite. And David draws what is opposite next. He draws the heart of God. David begins to show, in contrast to the corruption of man, the beauty of God, the beauty of God's heart, the beauty of God's nature. And in order to do so, he will use that which seems most grand. From the human mind, you would always struggle to describe who God is. But David here uses pictures that summarize, in the human mind anyways, the greatest examples of grandeur, of majesty, of inexpressible size. And that's nature. David uses pictures that he has seen in nature. We have seen them too sometimes. Maybe you've had the privilege of climbing up a mountain and standing up on the top of a lookout on top of a mountain, and all you hear is the wind blowing in your ears. Everything else is silent, and you look out for miles. And you feel tiny. Or maybe you've had times when you've been camping and there's the quiet of the night and you look back in your camping chair and all you see is the night sky and the stars spread across it like millions of dots on a black canvas. And in those moments we do feel small. These great vistas of nature where you hear nothing but wind. These great views of the stars which are so many billions of light years away. And we do feel small in those moments. And that's what David is using to describe God and his greatness. And he begins by describing God's steadfast love. That God's steadfast love extends to the heavens. David, speaking of steadfast love and faithfulness, dealing with man's relationship with God, or God's relationship rather, with the redeemed. And God in his steadfast love is reminding us in this psalm of his commitment. God has made a commitment to his promise to his people, which will never be revoked. His promise is sure. His promise is dependable. And his faithfulness, much in the same way, endures despite all their faithlessness. It's like man looking up into the heavens and seeing the grandeur of the sky, the majesty of the stars, and saying that is what God's love for his people is like. It's not like human love. God is faithful to us even when we are faithless. It's thought to be one of the very earliest of hymns of the Christian church. It's recorded for us in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 11 through 13. It says there, the saying is trustworthy, for if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. This is the picture that David is painting for us, the faithfulness of God, his steadfast love for his own people. It's as great as from here to the heavens. His faithfulness is from here to the clouds. In essence, it's beyond our comprehension. We can't comprehend that kind of distance from here to the heavens. And that's how David describes the steadfast love and the faithfulness of God. But he doesn't stay with steadfast love and faithfulness. He also deals with righteousness and judgments. And these describe, of course, God's relationship with the purity, with the sins of man. God's righteousness is like the mighty mountains. The judgments are like the great deep. Righteousness, of course, is purity in action. And the judgments of God are assessments of that purity. And God's righteousness is like the mountains. It's a picture of, from a human perspective, looking out into the world and the experience that we have in the world. A mountain is, in my own estimation anyways, one of the most immovable things that I can imagine. You see a mountain in all its grandeur and its space, and there's nothing that can move that mountain. And that's how God's righteousness is described. God's judgments are described as the depths of the ocean covered in great mystery. Sometimes still, even today, we think we're so advanced. Every once in a while you hear of a discovery of another creature in the deep ocean. And these creatures, they will blow you away, what they look like and the things that they can do in terms of producing light and all sorts of other weird stuff that I don't understand how any of that works. But God understands how that works because he is the creator of the great ocean deeps. These strange creatures which we have not mastered, which we have not known, which we have not understood, God made them, and he understands all of it. The same is true with his judgments. We do not understand his justice, but to him it is known like the great deeps of the ocean. To the natural man, of course, that is a great contrast, because the natural man has no righteousness of his own at all. All we need to do is look at Romans 3 and verse 10 and following, where it speaks of the depravity of man. It gives us a great picture that nobody seeks after God. Everybody's corrupt in all their ways. They all hate God. Everybody goes their own way. There is no righteousness in man. That's why Christ came. Christ came so that his righteousness would be imputed to us. No one is righteous. No, not one. Christ's death is needed. His righteousness is imputed. It's not native in man at all, because man is like that black canvas. Man, his heart, in his natural state, speaks only transgression. The judgments of man are imperfect and incomplete because the knowledge of man is imperfect and incomplete. Man is the blackness to which God's purity is the most opposite contrast. And when man, through the illuminating work of the Holy Spirit, sees this contrast in his heart and compares his own heart against the heart of God, there is a great turning to God. And you see that expressed already by David in part in verse 7 and 8 and 9. The Spirit awakens in the regenerate an awareness of his need for salvation, his need for God's steadfast love and the security it provides. How precious is your steadfast love, it says in verse 7. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. And in this steadfast love of God, the natural man, converted and made new again, feasts with the most unimaginable feast you can describe. David here describes it for us as an abundance of God's house, drinking from the river of your delights. I'm used to drinking out of a cup. Even in America, I mean, we can get a big cup in America. We can, right? But we never drink out of a river of God's delights. This is a feast beyond our description here in our own imagination even. David is using the places where man enjoys himself most, in feasts, in celebrations, and he bumps up the imagery a little bit, makes it even more amazing for us. This is what life is like in the presence of the purity of God compared to man living in the darkness of his own heart. God actually dispels the darkness of man's heart. Did you notice that in verse 9? In your light do we see light. Of course, Jesus is the light who comes into the world. In John's Gospel, the 12th chapter and the 46th verse, that's how Jesus identifies himself. He says, I have come into the world as light, so that whoever believes in me may not remain in darkness. Now, I don't know if I've told you this story before. Maybe I have, and you'll have to bear with me if I have. But one time, Lisa and I went on a trip in California to an abandoned gold mine. And they walked us into this gold mine, and they had lights all along the track. It was great. Like, you walk in, it's very interesting. You see all these little rooms, and they walk in about a mile. And once you're walked in about a mile, they shut the lights off, and you can't see a thing. It is blackness. You remember during the 10 plagues, blackness that you could cut with a knife, right? It's so black. You can't imagine how black it is. And then, fortunately, one of the guides, of course, has a flashlight. And they turn on that flashlight. And you can almost hear a sigh of relief, even in all the grown-ups. I mean, we're all grown-ups walking in there. And you can almost hear that sigh of relief. And everybody's looking at that light because the contrast is so stark. And that's what it's like with Christ. The darkness of man's heart is so black, and in that blackness, Christ comes, and he shines his light. In your light, we see light. It is in the light of Christ that we walk. It's in the light of Christ that we see again as fallen and broken creatures. The hope for the heart of the natural man is only found in the purity and righteousness of Christ. And David, he knows this. That's why it's so significant that he identifies himself as the author of this psalm as the servant of the Lord. He doesn't come as a great man. He knows who he is. He knows who he is compared to God, and he comes in humility. David is the servant. He has learned his lesson, and he finishes his psalm by turning to God with intercession in verses 10 through 12. He speaks of the work of God. To recognize the truth about God and man is the very foundation for the confidence of the regenerate. To know our nature is to see our sin and our misery. To know who we are is to say, I am desperate and I am helpless and I am in need of redemption. To see the blackness of your heart, to see the hopelessness of your condition, is only to make the light of Christ brighter for you. It is in our own darkness and realizing it that we see our need for redemption. And when we see God's steadfast love, His faithfulness, His righteousness, His judgments, we see that white light in the middle of that black wall. We see that white splatter of paint on that black wall. And when we sit in that room in front of the darkness of our own heart and the Holy Spirit is working in your life, all you will see is that white streak or that white dot, because you will see the contrast with your own being. Your eye, the eye of your heart, will constantly be drawn to it. This steadfast love that God gives to His people. This is the cry of David's heart as he begins to talk in verse 10. Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. Who knows God? Who is upright in heart? It is the one to whom God has given new life, to the one to whom God has granted salvation. Those who know the Lord are upright. But the heart of natural man is only transgression. It's only sin, and it's only rebellion. They don't want to know God, and their hearts are bent on evil. But when the fear of God is implanted in the human heart, his cry will be for God's steadfast love to be established, as David does here in verse 10. This steadfast love is seen in the work of Christ most clearly. And he takes natural man and he makes him a new creation and he shows him his steadfast love and his promises rest on him through his work. And in verse 11 and 12, as David concludes this psalm, you see that in the steadfast love of God, we have this great confidence as God's people. When we live in the condition of natural man, we are fearful. We can be overwhelmed at any time. But when we live under the shadow of the wings of God Almighty, we do not have fear that the foot of the arrogant will crush us, that the hand of the wicked will drive us away, because we know. We know that these men who lie on their beds plotting evil, we know that these men who speak in the very essence of their being, they speak sin and evil and rebellion, in the end they will lie fallen, they will lie impotent, they will lie lifeless, and all their plans will come to nothing. So in response to this psalm from David, I would exhort us in the following ways. First, that we would not deceive ourselves, but that we would know our heart. Now, we spoke about this a little bit this morning. I want to think about it a little bit more this evening. How often is our response to sin, whether our own or somebody else's, well, that's not really that bad. What's the big deal with that sin? Now, I would grant you, certainly not every sin is as heinous as the next sin. But our approach to sin can never be to shrug it off. To shrug off sin is to take the first step of the natural man that he does in verse 2 of this psalm. Flattering himself with his own eyes that his iniquity cannot be found out and that his iniquity cannot be hated. If we begin to think that our sin is not a big deal, we will be slow to flee to Christ. And to be slow to flee to Christ is to take his work on the cross for granted. I want us to think together about how sin came into the world. Sin did not come into the world, beloved of God. It did not come into the world through murder. It did not come into the world through adultery. It did not come into the world by taking the Lord's name in vain, by cursing God up and down. It came into the world by eating a piece of fruit. And because of that little sin, the entire human race is condemned. This is how God views sin. Now, there was plenty of the big sins after that, right? I mean, there's plenty of adultery and murder and all that stuff in the pages of Scripture. But God cares as much about the rebellion of eating fruit as he does about the rebellion of marring his image in murder. We can't say, surely eating a forbidden fruit is not a big deal. It is the very first expression of transgression that speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. And so rebellion against God in all its form and in any of its forms is an affront against him. So how do you view sin? How do you view man? Of course, our temptation is to think that only the big ones matter, murder and adultery and theft and all and those things. But all lawlessness is sin. And all sin is the foundation of condemnation. In the sins, even the little sins, we call them little sins, we see the foundation of our need for Christ. We see the blackness of the decor of our heart. And if we are regenerate, even what the world would call little sins, we see for the blackness that it is. And we contrast it with the purity of Christ and his righteousness imputed to us. So, do not deceive yourself, but know your heart. Know that even in your little sins, you are rebelling against God, and you are deserving of His condemnation. But then on the flip side, I would also exhort us to study the majesty of God and His attributes. Part of knowing the glory of God is seeing and understanding the natural man and who we are in our nature. But it's also known in understanding who God is. It is in knowing man and knowing God that we see the contrast, that we see the greatness of our salvation. It is in the contrast between God and man that the wonder of our redemption is known. Do you want to refresh your zeal for the gospel? Do you want to rekindle that enthusiasm that you remember from some time in your life when God converted you or when He was sanctifying you in a powerful way and you were seeing yourself grow day after day and on fire for His word and all those things that we remember? Do you want to recapture that? Then understand the difference between who you are in your nature and who God is in His heart. And see the wonder of God Almighty reaching down from heaven and caring for people such as we are and shining a light in the utter blackness of our soul. Study God. Study His steadfast love. Know His faithfulness. Talk about His righteousness together. Think about His judgments and delight yourself in them. To know God's heart, to know God's nature, leads to the cry of the saints, which says, "Continue, O God, to shower Your steadfast love on us, because we are not deserving, because we are not worthy." This psalm, it's effective. It's effective in teaching us the abiding zeal that can be ours in Christ. And it shows us the astounding difference between man's desires and God's desires, and man's nature and God's nature. And it refreshes in our mind, or it should refresh in our mind, this great dependence that we have on the Lord. Christ is manifest. His light is shone on the darkness of mankind. So, know this difference. Know it every single day afresh, my brothers and sisters, so that we would live each day, not just on this day, but each day, clinging to the steadfast love of God. Let's pray together.